everyone. Good evening. Welcome, welcome. First of all, happy Halloween and welcome to Genoviva's production Unhinged Reading Series. My name is Julia Genoviva and this is my associate Gus Ferrari in the corner there. Thank you so much, you guys, for being here tonight. So this is a brand new reading series for Genoviva Productions. And we decided what a great time to launch this in Halloween. So thank you so much for being here. In the chat is the lineup for this evening. So we have the plays Quarantine by William Cosey, then Depths from Beyond and LaRouche Pantra, The Red Painter by me, yours truly, Beatrix Potter Must Die by Patrick Gabridge, and then to wrap up the evening, we have a special presentation of The Raven by Edgar Allan Poe from Gus Ferrari. So thank you for being here with us tonight. I hope you enjoy our evening of creepy and scary plays. And I'll see you guys after. So sit back, relax, and turn those lights off if you dare.
Quarantine by William Cosey, adapting a scene from Stephen King's The Stand. Setting, a very spare quarantine room with a locked door, a cot, toilet, a small cage on a table with two small guinea pigs. The time is the future. A man, Stu Redmond, sits on a chair, looking at the guinea pigs in the cage. He sticks his finger close to the cage and engaging the guinea pigs playfully. After a moment, a few clicks are heard from the door, and as it opens, a slight whoosh of air sounds. Stu Redmond bolts up from his chair, looking toward the door. Dr. Dietz enters, and as the door closes behind him, he swipes it with a card and puts the card in his pocket. He holds the clipboard and steps towards Stu.
Mr. Redmond, how are you? I'm Dr. Dietz. I understand from the nurses that you are refusing to cooperate with any more blood tests until you get some answers.
That's right.
I see. Well,
Dr. Dietz walks over to the table and takes one of the chairs and pulls it over to sit down a few feet from Stu, facing him.
So, what questions do you have for me?
Well, first thing I'd like to know is, I just saw someone walk by still wearing one of those hazmat suits, and no one's ever come in here without one. Why aren't you wearing one?
Well, right. You see, that's because, Mr. Redmond, you are not contagious for some reason. That's one of the things that we're trying to figure out. Now, you'll have to excuse Dr. Jettinger's less than cheerful bedside manner, but you can understand that he, as well as everyone else, is under a tremendous amount of pressure here. Tests we're running are crucial to finding out answers to questions like, why aren't you contagious?
Well, how do you know I'm not? And what in hell is it? The flu? Some kind of virus?
Oh, you're not contagious, because if you were, those little guys there would be dead by now.
Looking toward the guinea pigs.
They can catch it from me?
In your case, apparently not. You see, they've been breathing the same air as you in this room for 5 days now, and nothing. With everyone else, though, the guinea pigs all died after 24 hours.
Everyone else? And what about them? Well, how are all the people?
Dietz looks at his clipboard and turns a page over.
Well, these are the people that we brought in with your group. Victor Palfrey, deceased. Norman Brewitt, Joanne Brewitt, Robert Brewitt, Catherine Brewitt, deceased.
Jesus, the whole family.
Thomas Wanamaker, deceased. Ralph Hodges, Cheryl Hodges, Bert Hodges, all deceased.
Stu flops down in his chair.
Christian Ortega, deceased. Anthony Leo Minster, deceased. Those were all the people in your group that we brought in.
My group? Well, how many other groups are there?
I'm afraid that's classified information.
That means that there are others. How many others? How many?
Mr. Redmond, some information is classified. That's just the way it is. You know, I'm truly sorry for the loss of your friends, though.
There's no one?
No one survived more than 2 days after exposure. You know what? And that makes you very special. That's why it's vital that you please cooperate and not resist any more blood tests. Can you do that?
Well, what is it? What did we all catch?
Again, I'm afraid that's classified.
Well, where else is this going on? How widespread is this?
I'm afraid that's classified, too.
I mean, is it happening in other states? Around the world?
Down at his clipboard.
Is it happening around the world?
I'm sorry. That's all classified.
That man, the one who had it bad and drove to the service station where we all were, he exposed us. Well, where did he catch it from?
That's classified too.
There's an army base near here, up the road from where he drove in from. My guess is something happened up there. Something went wrong. Is that right?
Well, I'm sorry.
God almighty, you guys really fucked up, didn't you? Well, what happened? Some test tube break? A gas leak from some fucking chemical weapon bullshit experiment?
That man that drove the car, the situation exists. It's here, and we're trying to cope with it. Fighting us, Mr. Redmond, is not going to help.
So you're not even willing to say who's responsible. You have no problem with keeping me here without a warrant, without legal counsel. But you won't even give me that small satisfaction, huh? Can't even tell me what's causing you to imprison me for committing no crime. No crime at all.
Mr. Redmond, I'm not unsympathetic.
Well, ooh-wee. Thank God for that.
Mr. Redmond, I could probably get in trouble for telling you even the little bit that I've told you. In a way, I mean, you should probably be thankful that I'm not telling you more. You see, at this point, you've disappeared from the world. No one knows where you are. Now, imagine if the higher-ups felt like you knew too much.
What?
Mr. Redmond, I'm really not much more than a small cog in a big wheel of a machine that was thrown together very quickly when this whole thing exploded. But the higher-ups, they're already fighting panic, I'm imagining. What if they decide that you know too much, huh? To tell you the truth, I don't even know exactly what the whole deal is. What if the higher-ups felt like you heard too much or you know too much? And then decide it would be safest if you disappeared.
And now you're threatening me. Oh, Jesus Christ.
Mr. Redmond, please. I'm not responsible for keeping you here. I'm not. None of the other doctors, none of the nurses are. If anyone is, you can lay the blame at that man, Mr. Campion, who unfortunately drove you away.
And you can't even tell me what he had.
I'm sorry, but that's classified.
Yeah, I know. Well, there was another group that was collected up and taken somewhere. Those folks down the road in Pikeville, they all died too?
No.
You're lying.
I'm sorry that you feel that way.
Well, how long do you plan on keeping me locked up here?
I don't know.
Classified?
No, I honestly just don't know. I mean, you don't have the disease for some reason. It's unknown to us. I mean, even though you were clearly and closely exposed to it, you can understand the importance of learning why that is, can't you?
Yeah, just shut up and serve my country, right?
Here right now is the safest place on earth for you right now. In fact, it's the safest place for anybody. Can you look at it that way?
What are their names?
Excuse me?
These two.
Stu points to the guinea pigs.
I don't really know. One of the nurses might want me to ask.
Whatever.
I can tell Dr. Redmond that you're going to agree to more tests. Can I do that, please?
Not used to going 5 days without a shave. Feels a little itchy.
I can get an orderly in here right now to give you a nice shave.
I can shave myself. Been doing it for years.
Sorry, but no.
Come on now. You think I'm so bummed out that I'll kill myself?
Not exactly.
Well, fine then. Yeah, sure. Look, let the nurse check my blood pressure and and feel free to. Damn.
He looks concerned and stands up.
Open the door. Open.
He props his hand on the table, holding himself up as he coughs and has trouble breathing. He fumbles in his pocket for the key card. He pulls it out, but it drops on the floor. He frantically drops his clipboard and swipes the key card, and the door clicks.
It's all right, Doc. Don't worry. I was faking.
You were faking? You were faking it?
Yeah.
What? Why in the world would you do such a thing?
Classified.
Deet stares at Stu but says nothing. He exits. Stu turns back to the table facing the guinea pigs. He sits down and puts his finger up to the cage. Again, as the guinea pigs scurry over to sniff him. The end.
Bravo! Bravo!
And now our next play, Depths from Beyond.
Depths from Beyond by Julia Genoveva. Lights up. Marcia opens the door and enters with Rebecca. They are walking into the living room full of beautiful Victorian house style. The house is filled with elegant paintings and furniture that looks like it came straight from the 1800s. A painting of Charles Dickens hangs by the staircase.
Wow, this place got even more beautiful since the last time I saw it.
Congratulations. Here are the keys. You are officially a homeowner.
Because of you, my husband and I finally have our dream home.
But I didn't really do anything. You found me, remember?
You didn't have any other prospective buyers?
Nope.
I can't believe that I was the only one to answer your ad in Zillow.
Well, I did have a few applicants, but I chose you. Anyway, let's just call it fate. The house was waiting for you, and you and your husband, of course. And the furniture and everything that's in it, it's yours too. The previous owner, Mrs. Gertrude Stein, died 35 years ago of a heart attack.
I'm so sorry. Did you know her?
Yes, you could say that. And her daughter, Beatrice, died a year before Gertrude's death. Those were dark times. Anyway, this house could use a fresh coat of blood. that was a joke, of course.
Right. The house does look like it needs a fresh paint job.
My suggestion is that you settle in first and then little by little, focus on making this amazing house your own.
You're right. I'm getting ahead of myself.
Oh, the joys of being young and enthusiastic. So you just got married, huh?
Yep, we are, as they say, newlyweds.
How nice. Now, don't wait too long to put those buns in the oven. You know, the biological clock. Tick-tock, tick-tock.
no plans on that yet. Anyway, I need to check in with my husband and start unpacking. He'll be here tomorrow night. We are so grateful to you. Thank you so much.
Hush now. I'm happy if you're happy. I'll be on my way then. So I'm not far if you need me.
I really appreciate it.
Au revoir, ma chérie.
Marcia exits.
Babe, I'm here. I made it. I'm sitting on the couch of a brand new house. Wait till you see this place. You know I have great taste. And we need to keep all the furniture. Oh my God, the style is all like Victorian goth. It is so up our alley. Yeah. The drive was kind of long and the real estate agent, Marcia, she's nice, but she's really, really old school. I miss you. How was the conference? Wow. Oh my God, that's awesome, baby. I can't wait to see you tomorrow. Oh. Yeah, I'm feeling a little tired. I think I'm gonna go and lay down for a while. I love you, baby. Okay. Call me when you're on your way. Okay. Bye.
He hangs up the phone, takes off her sneakers, and stretches out on the couch.
I think a little power nap is going to hit the spot.
Becca closes her eyes and starts to drift off. Suddenly, all the lights of the house begin to flicker on and off, and there is a diabolical voice in the air.
Beatrice! Beatrice! Come out wherever you are.
Becca jumps up off the sofa and nervously walks around.
What? Who's that? Who's there?
You were trying to leave me, weren't you?
Who's there? How did you get in here? Show yourself!
You grateful, ungrateful little brat, after everything I've done for you?
If you don't come out, I'm calling the cops. I have my cell phone right here.
Everything that's hanging on the wall starts shaking and hits the floor with a loud crash.
What in the actual fuck?
As she's about to leave, a cold hand grabs her shoulder, jolts her back, and knocks her to the floor. Gertrude appears in a
going
light gray shadow.
Little bitch, I'm your mother.
My mother? What? Who? Wait a minute. You're that woman! Gertrude! What the fuck? You're an actual fucking ghost?
Stands and tries to leave again.
Aha! There you go.
Gertrude grabs Rebecca by the wrist and they slide upstairs. Suddenly, they are inside a room. The walls, the bed, everything is pink. There is a poster of the movie, The Breakfast Club. It's the year 1985. Rebecca starts banging on the door.
You're coming with me.
Open this door! Somebody help me!
No one can hear or see Rebecca. Gertrude is speaking to a beautiful young girl. She's a brunette with very curly hair. Her makeup is bright eyeshadow and lipstick, all dressed up in trendy 80s clothes.
You can't keep me in this room forever. James and I are in love and we're getting married. There's nothing you can do about it.
What about your old mother and your sister? You're just going to walk out on us? What about the promise you made to each other that after your father's death, that it would be just the three of us.
Oh, that is a stupid tradition you made up in your head. I never agreed to that. You can't stop me from living my life.
How can you talk to your own mother like that? You've always been so selfish and self-centered. Just wait till your sister finds out about this. It's going to break her heart. I'm ashamed that I ever gave birth to you. You're a bad sister and a horrible daughter.
I love the both of you very much, but now it's time for me to have my own life. I'll still be around.
You'll still be around? Like the mailman's around?
James and I are leaving tonight, and there's nothing you can do to stop us.
Beatrice stands, but then stumbles right back on the bed.
Oh, what did you do? Did you put something in my food?
I gave you life, and now I'm taking it away. I'm your mother, and I own you.
Mom, I can't see anything. Everything looks so blurry. I feel so dizzy.
The whole room goes black. Then Rebecca is right back in the living room and laying on the couch. There was a loud knock on the door.
What? What just happened?
The knocking continues.
Just a sec.
She gathers the strength to stand up and open the door.
My dear, I'm so sorry to disturb you, but I forgot the spare set.
Huh? Spare?
For your husband. Spare keys.
You didn't need to come back for that.
Ugh. Are you okay? You don't look well. You look like you've seen a ghost. Sorry. Bad joke again.
There's something very weird going on in this house.
What in God's name are you talking about? I mean, this is the most peaceful place on earth.
I saw that woman who lived here, Gertrude, and her daughter, Beatrice.
That's impossible. I already told you that they died over 30 years ago.
I'm not crazy. I know what I saw. And everything that was hanging on the wall, what was all over the floor, and there was glass. There was glass all over the place.
glass. I don't understand. There's no glass on the floor. Everything's in its proper place and proper order, just like I left it.
There was glass. I saw it. It was all over the place.
But there's nothing on the floor.
And I heard all this noise, and I saw her.
Maybe it was a bad dream, a little separation anxiety, because you're alone in a new house without your husband.
But she grabbed me, and I felt her cold hands.
Grabbed you. Someone actually grabbed you.
Gertrude.
Oh my, this does sound like a ghost story. Aren't we a little too old for that?
You weren't here. It felt so real. And the way that she treated that poor girl. She poisoned her. She killed her. I saw everything. I can't be here. I really think I need to go.
Go?
Yes, go. Spend the day in a hotel and then come back with Derek tomorrow night. Maybe this place isn't right for us.
That's absolutely insane. I mean, this is your house now. You can't just leave.
I don't feel comfortable being here alone.
You know what? I have an idea. Why don't you walk me through it? I mean, moment by moment. Tell me exactly what happened. Maybe that'll make you feel better. And if it doesn't, then I will drive you to a hotel myself and I'll give you all your money back.
Really?
Of course, I feel terrible about this.
Like I was saying, she grabbed me and then she took me upstairs.
Well,
and
this story is getting more and more strange.
I'm not lying. I can show you.
Yes, good idea. Show me. I want to see how things happen from your point of view.
Go upstairs and Rebecca opens the door to Beatrice's room.
The three of us were in this room, but they couldn't see me. But I saw everything. She was yelling at that poor girl and
Beatrice?
Yes, yes. She was telling her that she could never leave this house, that she could never get married.
You know how crazy this sounds, right?
Then Gertrude poisoned her own daughter. I'm telling you the truth.
You realize you're talking about dead people. I just need a moment. My head is just spinning from all this. Why don't I go downstairs and make us tea to calm our nerves?
I could use something to calm me down.
Just sit and relax, and I'll be right back.
Marcia suddenly slams the door and locks it.
What's going on? What are you doing? Why are you locking me in here?
You're never leaving this room.
What are you doing? Let me out!
Gertrude was my mother. And she made my sister Beatrice pay with her life. She wanted to leave us. No one can ever leave us. I want mother to be happy. So I bring her a new daughter every year. Mother, mother, look what I have for you. Aren't you proud of me?
Gertrude appears next to Marcia.
You are the best daughter a mother could ever ask for.
I locked her in Beatrice's room, Mom, just like always. She's all yours.
Rebecca continues to scream and bang on the door. Then Gertrude gently passes through the door with a big smile on her face. She looks back at Marcia lovingly. The entire house trembles and shakes like an earthquake. Marcia holds onto the wall to keep her balance. After a few moments, silence. Everything in the house is back to normal, as if nothing happened.
Until next year, Mother, I will never disappoint you. You can always count on me, even from the other side. I think I'll have a tea after all.
1 year later, Marcia opens the door and a young woman walks in with her. Marcia walks to the window and draws the curtains to let the sunlight in.
Isn't this house a beauty? And it comes fully furnished. The previous owner died 35 years ago and had no next of kin. So shall I show you the upstairs?
Play blackout.
Our next play of the evening is Lelouch Pontre, The Red Painter by Julia Genoveva. Scene one, Aaron's loft, empty bottles of alcohol everywhere. Old newspaper clippings of a painter by the name of Dante all over Aaron's desk and floor. Some are ripped, crumbled up. Aaron is attempting his next painting, but he's drunk, frustrated, and enraged. His appearance is disheveled, dark circles under his eyes, and has not shaved in days. He's throwing things across the room in total disgust with himself.
I can't get you out of my head. Why can't I get you out of my fucking head?
Flashback. In Aaron's mind, a little boy dragging his father by the hand to show him his artwork in his room. Look, Daddy, I'm a famous painter, just like you.
The lines and the colors, they are nauseating. You have a long way to go before you can be like me, the great Dante. This just doesn't happen overnight. Years of practice and hard work. You are worthless. How dare you drag me away from my studio to show me this garbage? Start over, and no dinner for you tonight. And you shall not leave this room until you can create something that is worthy of my eyes to behold.
Dante storms out. Little Aaron is crying and devastated. Back to the present.
Well, now, old man, now you'll be rolling over in your grave because I'm going to be greater than you ever were. And I'm going to make people forget about your legacy. And then it's going to be me destroying your paintings and your name with my bare hands.
Scene two, exterior, New York City. Outdoor shots of Manhattan, noise, hustle and bustle of people passing by. Then slowly, the camera begins to take us somewhere, a cozy downtown bar. The camera shots become closer and closer, focusing on the establishment, and then we are inside. Scene three, interior, a bar. Aaron is sitting by a table having a drink. Mia is sitting by the bar, waiting and growing impatient. The bartender places a drink in front of her.
I didn't order this.
Your secret admirer did.
Send it back.
The guy pays for it. I make it. You drink it. That's the way it works.
I'm on a date.
Yeah. With who? Your imaginary friend?
He's just a little late.
Yeah, well, at this point, I'd say he's a no-show.
Whatever. You're just a bartender. What do you know? I have never been stood up before. I mean, look at me. Would you stand me up?
No, ma'am.
Exactly. So keep making those drinks and mind your own business.
Yes, ma'am.
Aaron enters.
Your phone there, it just can't capture how beautiful you are. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to sneak up on you. I've been watching you all this time, and so I just thought to myself, well, it's now or never.
Thanks for the drink.
Would you like another one?
Is this some kind of drinking competition?
No, not at all.
You really don't need to do this.
Well, you know, you looked a little bit sad.
Annoyed, actually. I am being stood up. Mia Estrada, this is the first time this has ever happened to me. No phone call, no text, not even an email. What an asshole.
Well, you know, I'm sorry. But, you know, this actually works out for me because now I'm the one who gets to enjoy your company.
And just to be clear, it's not like I can't find my own date. I just didn't want to waste another night with some weirdo, so I let my friend set me up.
Well, I'm sure any guy would give his right arm to be graced by your presence.
I had a feeling nothing good would come out of this. But my roommate was like, it's a free dinner, why not? I am just beyond humiliated. I just want to go under the covers and not come out until tomorrow morning. Anyway, so long.
Please, don't go. Would you like to stay for another round?
No, this blind date fiasco killed my buzz.
Please? I'm asking please?
This is the worst night of my life. Don't you get it? I don't want to be here.
Come on. Just, you know, live a little. I mean, it's a beautiful night. We can't have you all dressed up with no place to go.
Well, now that you mention it, that is a very good point. This is a very expensive dress.
Two more? Okay, first question. So are you from New York?
I just moved to New York a couple of months ago. Something about this place is just so hypnotizing and exciting. My hometown is Snoozeville, and I just needed some adventure.
Well, then you've come to the right place. New York City never gets boring.
Bartender places the drink in front of them.
This is on the house, lovebirds.
Okay. Thanks, buddy.
And New York is filled with rich and famous. Maybe I can meet my rich and hot future husband here.
Well, I hope not, because then I would never get to see you again, and, well, that would just break my heart.
I have broken many already. You would just be another one on the list.
Wow, that is very, very cold.
But seriously, I am not going to settle down until I meet the man who can give me everything I deserve. My father didn't have a penny to his name, and he was cheating on my mother left and right. Oh, she was such a fool. And that can never be me. Being in love is for stupid people. So I am going to use this and not this.
Yeah. Well, I understand your pain. I didn't have a very happy childhood either. Just seems as though it's only when I'm painting that I can forget all my problems.
You're a painter. What do you paint?
Beautiful women.
Beautiful women.
Yeah. But none of them were as beautiful as you. Oh, boy, I wish we could have met last week. I mean, I had an art exhibition downtown in Soho, and I got to sell several pieces.
Very impressive. Did you sell them for a good price?
Well, yes. since you've asked. I also got commissioned to work on some exciting new paintings, very exclusive clients. I don't know if you read the Village Voice, but they interviewed me last month. But truth is, I don't think they understand what I'm all about.
I had no idea that you were this hot little artist.
I just want my life to mean something, you know? I'd like mm-hmm. to leave something behind. Something that tells the world that I tried to do something good with my life.
Wow. Poetic. Spoken like a true artist. I never thought about my life like that. I'd settle for lots of fame and money.
You know...
Yeah.
I was thinking. No, you're just going to think I'm weird.
Try me.
Well, I was watching you earlier. And I was thinking about how much I would love to paint you.
You were?
Yeah, I'm obsessed with my art. It's all I think about.
No one has ever painted me before.
Well, it's very unfortunate, and I find that hard to believe.
Never.
Well, you know, there's always a first time for everything.
Very true.
Listen, I don't want to pressure you, okay? Mm-hmm. But I would love to paint you. And if you would do me the honor, you know what? Here, let me give you my card, okay? Just think about it.
Right? Thank you.
I don't want you to feel uncomfortable.
Not at all. I feel very comfortable with you.
And I'm really happy you decided to stay.
Me too.
Well, listen, I don't want to keep you out late, so... Let's grab you a cab and get you home safe and sound, right? Check, please. Yeah?
Paint me tonight?
What? Really?
Carpe diem.
Listen, I don't want to press you to do anything that you don't want to do, okay?
Are you going to have my painting part of one of your art shows?
Don't. Most definitely.
and sell it for thousands of dollars?
Without a doubt.
I think this is fate. If my date wouldn't have stood me up, I would have never met you.
Ah, yes, that's true. I feel the same way.
Then it's all settled.
All right. Well, this is very generous of you. Thank you very much. You have no idea how much this means to me. I live and breathe for my work. Bonus, my place is only two blocks away from here.
Buy me a couple more rounds before we go.
Anything you want.
Scene 4. The living room. Aaron's apartment.
Well.
Mia and Aaron enter.
Here we are. Just make yourself at home.
This is wild. I can't believe I'm here. I don't even know you.
I can't believe it either.
You're making me blush.
Here, let me help you with your coat there, huh? Would you like some wine? I have this new Argentinian wine that just came out, and it's...
Sure. Yeah, well, maybe not. I have to work tomorrow, and I'm the new girl, so I'm getting all the abuse.
Why would anyone want to abuse such a gorgeous girl as you?
You always know what to say.
Listen, just one glass and you won't regret it. I promise.
I just can't say no to you.
Two glasses of wine coming right up.
Aaron exits.
You've got an interesting place here. The red walls, all those statues of gargoyles. What do you have, some sort of Victorian goth complex?
I was just going for that dramatic effect.
And what is this?
Aaron enters with two glasses of wine and gives one to Mia.
Here you are.
Thank you.
Well, to the meeting of two kindred souls. Mm-hmm. What do you say? Do you, you like them?
These are yours?
Yes, they are. But I could have done better.
It's wild, just wild. They remind me of the Scream painting, but much darker and eerie. Not that I know anything about art, but why all them?
What, women?
Screaming in pain.
Right. Okay. You know, I want to capture beautiful women in a state of torture, because I just feel like our society has this complex, this habit of always depicting women looking flawless. But I want to do the opposite. I want to expose the ugly side, you know, because it's in all of us. I just think we like to cover it up. We put a fake smile on our faces, right?
I had fun tonight, and the sushi was to die for.
I just hope tonight is not the last time I see you.
Maybe we'll see each other again.
Aaron kisses Mia.
I've never met anyone like you before.
Aaron kisses Mia again, and he takes her back to the sofa. They continue to kiss more passionately.
I feel the same way about you.
Yeah. Well, look at us. Here we are.
Aaron and Mia kiss again.
We drank so much tonight.
Yes, I know.
I think I had way too much.
Well, you seem to be handling your liquor very well.
Honestly, I feel a little lightheaded.
Yeah? Well, you want to just lie down and rest a little, and then we can start whenever you wake up, you know? No rush.
You're the perfect gentleman.
Mia lays down on the sofa and begins to doze off. Some time passes by, and Mia slowly wakes up.
Ah! The sleeping beauty awakens, but not from the kiss of a prince.
Oh, I feel like my head's being hit with a hammer or something.
Mia notices that her hands are tied.
What is this?
Once upon a midnight dreary, while I pondered, weak and weary.
What are you doing?
Over many a quaint and curious volume of forgotten lore, while I nodded, nearly napping, suddenly...
Get me out of here or you'll be sorry. What's going on here, you fucking psycho?
Come on. I was just getting to the best part of the poem.
Untie me right now.
Wait. You do know what that is, right?
What? Who? I just want to go home, please.
Well, that poem, that just popped into my head.
I don't give a shit about your fucking poem.
Hold. Whoa. Getting a little feisty there, aren't we, huh?
Aaron pulls a knife out of his back pocket.
You see this? Look at what I got here. Now listen, if you don't tell me what this poem is about, well then I'm going to take out one of those pretty little eyes. You know, I told you before that I've never seen anyone with eyes like yours. It would be a shame to lose one of them, wouldn't it? And deprive the world of all your beauty.
You're crazy. How did I not see this?
Be quiet. Silence. You little slut. Did you not hear what I just said? Now answer my question. Answer my question, or I'm gonna take one of those out.
Yes. I know this. I know this. It's The Raven by Edgar Allan Poe.
Now there's a good little girl. You see how easy that was? Why'd you have to make me, beat it out of you, huh? God, I feel like the raven right now, gently tapping at your chamber door. Except this is my chamber and we play by my rules. So now keep your fucking voice down or I'll take out your tongue also.
I already went along with your twisted game. Now let me go. What else do you want from me?
Well, you see, it's not that simple.
I won't say anything about this to anyone. I swear on my mother's life, I will take this to my grave. I'll go my way and we'll pretend like none of this ever happened. The dinner, me coming over, erased from our lives forever. I'll see you walking down the street and I'll pretend I don't even know you.
Shut up. Just shut your fucking mouth. Good God, you ever stop talking, you filthy tramp.
I'm sorry. Sorry, I'll be quiet.
You're not getting out of here unless I allow it. Don't you get that by now?
Please don't hurt me, please. I just moved here and there are so many things that I just...
You know what? I think it's time to be completely honest with you.
Honest?
Yes. Now just stop talking and just listen, okay?
What else is there to know?
Look, I'm only doing this because I really like it. You see, those other women, these other women, they never really knew why I did what I did.
From your paintings? Those women are real?
Well, of course. They're as real as you and me. Yeah. All those women have been here in this apartment and have sat on that chair just like you did. I didn't think you would be so easy, though. I have to say that. Anyway. Well, like I said before, I wanted to capture the ugly side of people. And in order to do that, it has to be based on reality. You understand? On a kind of torture that you would never want to feel for real. But then how can anything be done? How can anything be good if you don't feel it in every inch of your body? You understanding me? If it's not burning in the deepest part of your soul, if it's not based on reality, you see, only when something is real, then, and only then, can it be the greatest thing in the world. So that blank canvas over there is you.
I'll do whatever you want, but please don't hurt me.
Well, if you behave yourself, I won't.
Thank you.
Good. Yes. You know, it's hard for me to concentrate though with a lot of noise going on. So I'm just gonna have to do this. And it's long overdue. I think we'd agree because you're a bit of a chatterbox. Yep. Right.
No. Please don't cover my mouth.
It's just going to be for a little while. So
please,
There you go. I'm sorry. I can't believe you thought you would be getting out of here alive. Right. So now I'm going to really tell you the truth. You see, once I paint my subjects, I cannot allow anyone else to ever lay their eyes on them. I mean, what if they begin to see what I see or try to copy my vision? Right? It's too big of a risk. And if there's no way, I can take that chance, because after you exposed your darkest side to me, no one else can ever see it. So your secret has to stay safe with me. Now, I'm going to take you to a place where I've been doing my best work. There are a lot of fun toys and contraptions that we'll get to play with that will make you feel sensations that you have never felt before. And then, I'm getting very excited. So let's just start now, all right? Because I can taste your pain in my mouth, and you are going to look so beautiful. And I am greater than him. I am greater than him! Do you hear me?
Scene 5, exterior, New York City. Loud screams are heard from Aaron's apartment. Camera starts as a close-up, and shots get wider and wider, showing more of New York City. The screams are drowned out by the sounds of the street. It is just another normal night. Blackout. And now, our next play, Beatrix Potter Must Die.
Beatrix Potter Must Die by Patrick Gabridge. Time, 1900. Place, England. The drawing room in Beatrix Potter's London home. At Rise, Beatrix Potter, 34, sits at a desk in the drawing room of her London home, working on a manuscript. There should be a coat rack and umbrella stand with an umbrella. It is the year 1900. There is loud, fantastical clatter off stage. Beatrix looks up alarmed. Sam McGregor enters, carrying a futuristic laser blaster of some sort. He is in American dress and modern farm clothes, blue jeans, flannel shirt, feed cap. He is a little unsteady on his feet.
My heavens.
Are you Beatrix Potter?
Who are you?
I'll ask it again. Are you the Beatrix Potter, author and illustrator of the children's book, A Tale of Peter Rabbit?
No.
You're not?
Not yet. It is my dearest wish for it to be published someday, but I haven't completed it.
Perfect. I'm just in time. If you have any last prayers, now is the time to say them.
I don't understand.
I'm here to kill you.
Why?
You ruined my life.
I don't even know you. You sound like an American. I've never even been there.
Oh, you've done your damage worldwide.
Please, please don't shoot me. I beg you, Mr.
McGregor.
Mr. McGregor, please. You've made a mistake. The only work I've published are illustrations of fungal spores and fossils. A few greeting cards.
Yeah, so far. But once Peter Rabbit is published, you change everything.
Change everything?
Yeah. You make rabbits cute. But I'm here to stop you before it's too late. Might want to close your eyes.
No, stop. Don't you at least owe me an explanation?
I suppose I do.
Where are you from? How did you get here?
I'm from the future. I travel back in time.
You're an American scientist from the future?
I'm a farmer. My sister's the inventor.
And my book, which I haven't finished yet, has harmed you and your family?
My farm is overrun with rabbits. Cocky bastards. They're in the lettuce. They're in the French beans, the radishes, the biggest ballers ones eat my parsley just to soothe their fat tummies when they overeat my produce.
That has nothing to do with me.
I got a little farm in the suburbs surrounded by McMansions.
McMansions?
Tacky, oversized houses full of city folk who don't understand that the only good rabbit is a dead rabbit. They pass laws saying I'm not allowed to shoot them little fiends.
Perhaps fences.
They just squeeze under the gates. I make scarecrows. I keep cats. Look, chase the beady-eyed demons every chance I get. The other day, I came out to check on the beans that just sprouted. A horde of rabbits had bitten off the top of every single sprout. But I couldn't do a thing about it because of you.
Me?
Yeah, your little book comes out in 2 years and is wildly popular. Brave Peter Rabbit taking on mean old Farmer Smith, bringing home fresh veggies to his mother and brothers and sisters, Flopsy and Mopsy and Cottontail. Those cute little drawings and the merchandising, dolls, board games, tea sets. Before you, nobody ever thought rabbits were cute. Now they overrun the entire continent of Australia.
It's just a children's book.
Anti-farm propaganda. There's not a child in the world who has not read your filthy books.
You don't say.
Oh, but I aim to stop it. First you, then that whack job, Eric Hall.
I'm afraid I don't know him.
Well, he writes The Very Hungry Caterpillar about 70 years from now. The stuff of nightmares. Does the caterpillar get squished? No, he turns into a beautiful butterfly. And what about the farmer whose crops are ruined by that caterpillar? Do we see his suffering? Do we see him hocking his mother's wedding ring and selling off his favorite tractor to pay the mortgage? No, we don't.
It sounds tragic.
It is. I guess you and Eric Carl can commiserate in hell. Now, say goodbye, Miss Potter.
But don't shoot me, please. I didn't know.
Too late. I'm here and you've done what you've done.
But I haven't, right? Not yet. What if I just don't write it?
I think he's in you and it's got to come out.
What if I change the story?
Change it?
Is that why you're here? To change things? You don't want to shoot me.
Ain't so much I want to as I need to.
What if, instead of a hero, Peter is a scalawag?
Well, that would be a change.
What if he isn't supposed to go into the garden at all? His mother warns him not to.
Very sensible. Rabbits don't belong in gardens.
That's my message. Peter gets into terrible trouble.
That's better.
And he will suffer for being naughty.
Farmer shoots him.
No, let's take firearms out of the picture, shall we?
How about a pitchfork through the eye?
How about he catches a very bad cold and has to go to bed without any supper while Flopsy, Mopsy, and Cottontail have bread and milk and blackberries?
Peter doesn't get any.
Not a crumb.
There's a certain justice to that. But what if you don't keep your word?
You obviously know when and where to find me and are firm enough in your intentions to end my life and my work.
I am. I love that farm. And I hate those rabbits.
Perhaps in my revised story, I can make the farmer more handsome and appealing. I don't get to spend much time with actual farmers. Let me see what a farmer really looks like. Oh, yes. Would you mind if I take a few sketches?
I suppose so. I have nothing special.
I find that highly unlikely. You seem very strong and determined.
I like to think I'm just a hardworking man.
Certainly shows in your physique.
Oh, gosh, Miss Potter. You make me blush.
Could you stand closer to the window so I could imagine the sunlight falling upon you in the fields?
I'm out there, rain or shine.
But not with that thing in your hand.
Oh, this blaster now, right? I would have a shovel or a rake.
Beecher grabs an umbrella from her umbrella stand and offers it to him.
Ah, perhaps you could hold this instead, as if you were raising a rake over your head, ready to chase Peter Rabbit.
McGregor takes the umbrella and hands Beatrix the blaster. He raises the umbrella so that he's now the exact image of McGregor in the actual book.
Is this loaded? I don't want to shoot something by accident.
Oh, it's charged, but it's okay as long as the safety's on. You can't shoot anything unless that switch gets flicked up.
Oh, just like this. Just flick it up and pull the trigger.
You should just put that down and we can get back to making the art for your book, huh? The sketches, you know, my physique, huh?
I think I've seen enough to know how I will draw Mr. Farmer McGregor.
Now, Mrs. Potter, Beatrix, if I may, if you could just be careful where you point that thing.
I am pointing it exactly where I intend. You think I don't get suggestions from my parents? My brother, my editor, everyone has an opinion. And now you.
I didn't mean to criticize.
I have had enough. I will write it however I see fit. And if it makes Rabbit seem cute, then so be it. And if another writer chooses to delight children with the tale of a hungry caterpillar, then bunny for him.
I'll leave him alone, I swear.
Now you better. I will give you until the count of 10 to exit my home and return to your time machine.
Why don't you just...
One. And leave my umbrella.
Okay. I'm going peacefully, see?
Two.
I'm really sorry to have bothered you. But I'm not sure if I should leave that in the year 1900.
Four. I'm keeping it. In case you come back.
I won't, I promise.
Five, my friend will be very interested in this.
Your friend?
Six, H.G. Wells, your sister will know all about him.
I'm sure she does.
Seven, when I shoot you, will it hurt?
Okay, I'm gone.
Eight.
If you could be a little tougher on the rabbit though, please.
Nine.
He runs quickly out of the room with Beatrix on his heels. She stops at the doorway of the entrance. Off stage, we hear loud sounds of a time machine activating. Beatrix takes a deep breath, clicks the safety back on the blaster, and returns to her desk.
Farmer McGregor, Though perhaps Peter could be a bit naughty after all.
She sets down the blaster, picks up her manuscript, and starts making changes. Lights out, end of play.
And now for presentation, the last presentation of the evening, we thought it's very appropriate for this night, the night of Halloween. The night of mystery, the night of all that is unexplainable and strange. Now, please stand by for a dramatic reading of The Raven by Edgar Allan Poe with actor Gus Ferrari.
The Raven by Edgar Allan Poe. Once upon a midnight dreary, as I pondered, weak and weary, over many a quaint and curious volume of forgotten lore, while I nodded, nearly napping, suddenly there came a tapping, as of someone gently rapping at my chamber door. "'Tis some visitor," I muttered, "tapping at my chamber door. Only this and nothing more." Distinctly I remember, it was in the bleak December, and each separate dying ember wrote its ghost upon the floor. Eagerly I wished the morrow, Vainly I have sought to borrow from my books the seas of sorrow. Sorrow for the lost Lenore, for the rare and radiant maiden whom the angels name Lenore, nameless here forevermore. And the silken, sad, uncertain rustling of each purple curtain thrilled me, filled me with fantastic terrors never felt before, so that now to still the beating of my heart I stood repeating to some visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door, some late visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door, this it is and nothing more. Presently my soul grew stronger, hesitating then no longer, sir, I said, or madam, truly your forgiveness I implore, but the fact is I was napping, and so gently you came rapping, and so faintly you came tapping, tapping in my chamber door, that I scarce was sure I heard you. Here I open wide the door, darkness there, and nothing more. Deep into the darkness, peering long, I stood there wondering, fearing, doubting, dreaming dreams no mortals ever dared to dream before. But the silence was unbroken, and the stillness gave no token, and the only word there spoken was the whispered word, Lenore. This I whispered, and the echo murmured back the word, Lenore. Merely this, and nothing more. Back into the chamber turning, all my soul within me burning. Soon again I heard a tapping, somewhat louder than before. Surely, said I, surely that is something on my window lattice. Let me see then what thereat is, and this mystery explore. Let my heart be still a moment, and this mystery explore. 'Tis the wind, and nothing more. Open here flung the shutter, when with many a flirt and flutter, in there stepped a stately raven of the saintly days of yore. Not the least obeisance made he, not a minute stopped or stared he, but with mien of lord or lady perched above my chamber door, perched above a bust of Pallas just above my chamber door, perched and sat and nothing more. Then this ebony bird beguiling my sad fancy into smiling by the grave and stern decorum of the countenance that it wore. Though thy crest be shorn and shaven, thou, I said, art sure no craven. Ghastly, grim, and ancient raven wandering from the nightly shore. Tell me what thy lordly name is in the night's Plutonian shore. Quoth the raven, nevermore. Much I marvel this ungainly fowl to hear discourse so plainly, though its answer little meaning, little relevance it bore. For we cannot keep agreeing that no living human being ever yet was blessed with seeing bird above his chamber door. Bird or beast upon the sculptor bust above his chamber door with such name as Nevermore. But the raven, sitting lonely on the placid bust, spoke only that one word as if his soul in that one word he did outpour. Nothing further he didn't utter, not a feather he didn't flutter, till I scarcely more than muttered, other friends have flown before. On the morrow he would leave me as my hopes had flown before. Then the bird said, Nevermore. Startled at the stillness broken by reply so aptly spoken, doubtless, said I, what it utters it is only stuck in store, caught by some unhappy master whom a merciful disaster followed fast and followed faster till his song one burden bore, till the dirges of his hope that melancholy burden bore of never, nevermore. But the raven, still beguiling all my fancy into smiling, straight I wheeled a cushioned seat in front of bird and bust and door. Then upon the velvet sinking, I betook myself to linking fancy unto fancy, thinking what is ominous bird of yore, what this grim, ungainly, ghastly, gone, and ominous bird of yore meant in croaking nevermore. This I sat engaged in guessing, but no syllable expressing to the fowl whose fiery eyes now burn into my bosom's core. This and more I sat divining, with my head at ease reclining on the cushioned velvet lining that the lamplight gloated o'er, but whose velvet violet lining with the lamplight gloating o'er, she shall press, nevermore. Then methought the air grew denser, perfume from an unseen censer swung by seraphim whose footfalls tinkle on the tufted floor. Wretch, I cried, thy God has sent thee, by these angels he has sent thee. Respite, respite, and nepenthe from the memories of Lenore. Quaff, oh, quaff this kind nepenthe and forget the lost Lenore. Quoth the raven, nevermore. prophet said I, thing of evil, prophet, still if bird or devil, whether tempter sent or whether tempest tossed thee here ashore, desolate yet all undaunted in this desert land enchanted, on this home by horror haunted, tell me truly, I implore, is there balm in Gilead? Tell me, I implore, quoth the raven, nevermore. Prophet, said I, thing of evil, prophet, still, if bird or devil, by that heaven bends above us, by that God we both adore, tell this soul by sorrow laden, if within the distant Aden, I shall clasp a sainted maiden whom the angels name Lenore. Clasp a rare and radiant maiden whom the angels name Lenore, quoth the raven, nevermore. Be that word our sign of parting, bird or fiend, I shrieked upstarting, get thee back into the tempest and the night's Plutonian shore. Leave no black plume as a token of that lie that soul has spoken. Leave my loneliness unbroken. Quit the bust above my door. Take thy beak from out my heart and take thy form from off my door. Quoth the raven, nevermore. And the raven, never flitting, still is sitting on the pallid bust of Pallas just above my chamber door. And his eyes have all the seeming of a demon that is dreaming. And the lamplight o'er him streaming throws his shadow on the floor. And my soul from out that shadow that lets floating on the floor shall be lifted nevermore.
Hi guys, give everyone, this fabulous, talented cast, a round of applause. You guys were amazing. Thank you so much. Happy Halloween, audience. Please come and join us. You can turn on your video and audio.
Good job, everybody.
Great job. Those are great.
Spooky night, everybody.
Happy Halloween, everybody.
Hi, Stephanie. Oh my gosh, how are you?
Hi.
You look beautiful. Hi.
Happy Halloween.
You all look wonderful.
Gloria. Thank you. And we can open up the floor to any comments that you guys may have. Hey, Michelle.
Nice crown, Paul, by the way.
Thank you.
Yep. Yes, nice Paul. Very cross. Good.
Oh, I love the costumes, Lynn and Paul.
Hey, Lynn. Cody was really good.
Thank you. I hope we brought a little spook and fright for you guys tonight. Mm-hmm. Thank
hey,
you.
TJ, where are you?
I got dressed for the occasion.
Oh, my God.
Hello, Helene.
Great job, everybody. I'm not dressed for the occasion, so I'm keeping my video off. As I say, if you read
my chat.
Wait, as long
as you're dressed.
I look like Agnes Moorehead in the Twilight Zone episode when she was trying to get rid. I'm very schlumpy. It was my first day off in a long time where I got to relax.
Yes, so, yes. Thank you, everyone.
Well, I'm glad you shared it with us.
Yes, it was wonderful.
Guys, thank you for joining us. This is our first one-page reading series that we're doing. And we want to keep it going throughout the winter because I feel like, you know, we can all use something to escape from the everyday, something, you know, spooky and kind of mysterious. And then our next Unhinged reading series is going to be Saturday, December 12th at 7 p.m. So I hope you can join us for that. We'll have a brand new selection of creepy, spooky, and unexplainable plays. So I really hope to see you all again on December 12th. So thank you so much for taking time out.
Happy Halloween, everybody.
Happy Halloween.
Hi,
have a wonderful Halloween.
Happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween.
Halloween.
Bye-bye.
Did he vote yet? Make sure you do.
Bye. Charles Moran, show yourself.
There he is.
There he is.
Hi.
Oh, my God.
Hi, guys.
There he is.
Hi, Charles. That's great. I was just feeling bashful. not in New York right now.
You're in New York. Where are you right now?
I'm at my parents' house in Delaware. So.
Oh, okay. Tell Vicky we said hi.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, she's
I
in New York.
I see you, TJ.
Hey, Woody, thanks for inviting me. That was excellent.
I'm going to get you and your whole family.
I'm looking forward to that.
Fabulous and talented actors in the world. And I mean,
and we have the greatest producers.
Thank you for coming, TJ. We love you.
Love you guys.
So glad to see everybody.
Great to see you.
Somebody's attacking your head, Lynn.
Somebody's attacking my head.
Right, make the foot. Yeah.
Lynn, I love your costume. And Paul, that is so nice. I love that.
Julia, thank you so much.
There it is. There it is.
Hi, Charles.
Hey,
Paul. How you doing, Paul?
I like your bling bling mask.
Thanks for coming. Say hi to me.
That's pretty. I like the fact that you ascended from being a ghost into the outer space. That's lovely.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Much nicer.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you again, Stephanie, with the glamour.
See you next time. Thank you. Bye.
Take care.
Thank you, guys.
Bye.
Have a good night. Happy Halloween.
Thanks, Julia.
Good night, everybody, and thanks for the show.
Next time.